Okay, good afternoon, everybody. It's 4 o'clock in the afternoon in here in Amsterdam, and we're currently having 62 participants, so it's a fairly big crowd this afternoon. Welcome all of you to the first episode of the Uniface lectures. My name is Arjen van Vliet. I'm a pre-sales consultant for Uniface in Amsterdam. To close this, the Uniface lectures is a series that we do once a month. Every second Tuesday, we do a classroom session for people living in the Netherlands, here at the office in Amsterdam, and then the following Thursday, or perhaps a week later, we do the WebEx version. The classroom version is slightly different because it has a slightly bigger hands-on, and for this WebEx version we do a shorter demo because of the means that that are possible. So this lecture today is about Uniface 9.7 GUI modernization. And as I said, my name is Arjen van Vliet. I'm a solution consultant at Uniface, and today is Thursday, February 18th, 2016. A short overview of this lecture. First, we're going to talk about the Uniface 9.7 IDF or UDE modernization. Second part will be styling of entities and area frames. The third part will be a modernization plan in 10 easy steps, and we will conclude with a short demo. Please ask your questions in the chat during the presentation. My colleagues Adrian and Christy are here monitoring the chat, and we will provide you with an answer shortly. We have also a log on the chat, so we can always see all your questions afterwards and respond afterwards if necessary through Uniface Info, is mostly the means how we do this. So starting with part one, the modernization of the Uniface 9.7 development environment. By the way, this is our new styling for the Uniface lectures. It's done by Michael Rabone. I hope you like it. I think it looks very good. The modernization of the UDE. Product owners, product management, were looking for a new look and feel of the UDE using the new GUI features of Uniface 9.7. And one candidate stood out for low cost and high impact of the changes, and that was the start page. The goal of this all was attracting customers to modernize their apps and demonstrate the Uniface 9.7 GUI features by putting them into the UDE. The inspiration for this modernization staging came from Windows 8 and Windows 10 styling and the color schemes. It led to four teams in the UDE: mobile, web, desktop, and integration, with editor shortcuts to most used editors per theme, a restyled shortcut area. It looks fairly different from Uniface 9.6, and it's fairly customizable. Apart from the start screen, the shortcut creation and handling remains unchanged in the rest of the UDE. You now have as many shortcuts as you need. There's no limit. It's possible to filter on name. It's possible to sort on all columns in the grid. And there is one set of shortcuts, so no separate sets per theme. So here is a quick overview of the, so to say, old Uniface 9.6 and the new Uniface 9.7, with the themes, the theme areas: mobile theme, web theme, desktop theme, and integration. And combined with the selected team, the shortcuts of the most used editors in this team are displayed here. This morning, I got a question from someone from the audience asking if these were customizable. And no, these are not. These are fixed shortcuts. The customizable part is right here. Here you can now add your shortcuts. It's a little small right now, but later on in the demo we'll have a full screen version of this. It's a column-based thing, so you can sort on the columns, so on the shortcut name, on the description, etc. And on top of it, there's a search box which does a search as you type. So in the Uniface ADM users.ini file, and there is a possibility to play around with the theme and editor shortcut button fonts, and also with the color of the shortcut area frame, and with the profile and the shortcut fields properties. I would always advise to make a backup copy of the user's .ini file before you start editing, and do realize that you will edit the look and feel of your development environment. There's there has been a split between the common and the Uniface .ini file. And there have been added new IDF logical widgets which are not visible in the editor. There is an option to make these widgets visible, and it's done by adding a developer section in your usage.ini file and set show filtered widgets equals IDF. So the start page itself is also customizable. You will find start page.dev, which is an XML file in the common uses subdirectory. Theming buttons and editor shortcuts can be changed, as well as the editor shortcuts, what you see here. And again, I strongly advise to first make a copy before starting editing this. So this is this concludes part one of the presentation. We're going over to part two, the styling of entities and area frames. In Uniface 9.7, we added powerful options to modernize your Uniface application without having to change your code. And that's especially interesting for application running on different desktops, or application running for different customer sites. So that should be interesting for VARs. In 9.7, we took some steps to make this easier. We added new properties on the entity level that will enable you to make an entity area look nice. We added a mechanism to set these properties for individual entities in the .ini file, so outside of your code. We made all graphical entity properties available for the area frames too. These are only available from the .ini file. We will go into detail later on. So here's a small teaser slide. And it shows some of the possibilities now possible with Uniface 9.7. For instance, a gradient color from white on the top to powder blue on the bottom. You will see the edges here, the rounded edges. There's a shadow. There's a border. Border thickness can be adjusted, etc., etc. Color schemes can be changed, etc. I will go over the newly added properties with you. So there are new properties for the border, color, and image of the area frames and entities. Some already existed for shells, windows, or entities. The main groups of the newly added properties are border properties, background color properties, background image properties, and the attach property. And per main group, I will go into more detail in the next slides. So the border properties. You can give your entity or area frame different types of borders. The flat border, this border is 1 pixel in size and falls inside the area frame. This means that fields painted at the inner edge of an area frame override the border. By default, the border is dark gray. You can customize a flat border with the border color and border radius properties. Then there is the groove border type. A groove border shows an edge border with a width of 2 pixels and falls inside the area frame. There is no gap between the colored area and the border. The border that you can set in the Form Painter is separate from this and still works as it did before. If you have a border in the Form Painter and have specified border type property, you will see both. So, border color. The name is taken from the W3C standards as well as border radius, which is also taken from the W3C standards. Border color. When you have specified border type is flat, you can set the color of the border with border color. Border radius. When you have specified border type is flat, you can set the border radius to give the border round corners by specifying the number of pixels for the radius. The drop shadow color. When you specify a drop shadow color, your frame will be displayed with a shadow effect in the specified color. And a picture will make things clear. So here on top we have no border. Here the second one has a border type groove. Here the third one border type is flat. Border color is navy. Border type flat. Border color navy, border radius is 6 pixels, which gives the rounded edges over here. As you can see, the one above has no rounded edges. And this one has the drop shadow color navy blue, which is visible here. And if you add a radius of 6 pixels, you get the rounded edges here. So second group of properties, the background color properties. Going to back color fill. This defines whether the back color is shown as a solid color, back color fill is flat, or as a gradient color, back color fill is gradient. Flat is the default. The back color start. When back color fill has been set to gradient, the color by default runs from white to the specified background color. With back color start, you can make the gradient start from any other color. Gradient start. When you have specified back color fill as gradient, you can use gradient start to specify whether you want to start the gradient from the top, which is default, or from the bottom, from the left, or from the right. And again, I have a picture to make things clearer. Okay, first one has back color powder blue and back color fill is flat, so you see an equal powder blue over the whole area. Second one has the back color fill as gradient, so you see she's starting from white at the top, which is default, going to powder blue at the bottom. Third one has added the gradient start is left, so now the white part starts on the left and we go all the way to powder blue on the right. And the fourth and last one still has the same properties as the third one. But back color start is dodgy blue, has been added as a fourth line, which now means that it's no longer going from left to right white to powder blue, but it's going left to right dodgy blue to powder blue. So the third group of properties, these are the background image properties, starting with back image. With back image, you can specify an image that will be displayed as the background for the whole entity or area frame. This is not per occurrence. The H-align. You can set the H-align to left, right, or center to position the image horizontally. The H-scale. Set the H-scale to a percentage to scale the image. Default value is 100, which means that no scaling is applied, neither positive nor negative. Preserve aspect, you can set the preserve aspect to true to preserve the aspect ratio of the image. The default is false. The V-Align. Set the V-Align to top, bottom or center to position the image vertically. V-Scale. Set the V-Scale to a percentage to scale the image. Default is again 100, which means that no scaling is applied. And again, a nice picture to make things more clear. So the first one only has the triangle, the well-known Uniface logo, as a back image, and you can see that it fills the entity frame as a whole, where the aspect is not preserved. In the second one, preserve aspect is true is added, and now the aspect is preserved, of course. The third one has an H align to the left, which moves the triangle all the way to the left. Fourth one has a edge scale edit of value of 15. So you see that the triangle gets smaller and it's vertically aligned to the top all the way. And the last one, we have messed with the edge scale and the V scale values of 50 and 10. So you see that we sort of pull it all together. The fourth group of newly added properties. These are the attached properties. The attached property now also works on entity and area frames, and that is new. Of course, it was already there for fields, but now it's also there for entities and area frames. All values, left, right, top, bottom, edge move, V move, edge size, V size are supported. So in combination with setting the attached properties on fields, which was already possible in earlier versions of Uniface, you can now make resizable areas on your forms, which then looks like this. I'll slow down a bit. We have a bit of lag on the line. So this is actually the same Uniface form. Here it's stretched horizontally, and here is stretched vertically, and it's now possible to build a sort of responsive screens in client server mode. So about setting these properties, although the entities and area frames have the same new properties, there are differences in the way in which you can apply these properties. Setting the properties on entities is always possible through procroute. You can set the properties on entities using the familiar $EntityProperties function. All new properties are dynamic, so you can change colors, etc. at runtime. There has always been the property form, of course. For the entity, some of the properties that are discussed already exist. You can set them on the property form for the entity in the development environment. And the really new properties can be set on the more properties form. And we'll have a visual example of that of this on the next slide. The third way is through the .ini file. And in the ini file, the properties for entities can be set in the entity section. Assigning properties to dev entity applies to them to all entities in your application. So on the next slide, here's the example of the properties form and the more properties form in the UDE. And here you can see various new properties behind the more properties button. So, setting the properties on area frames. For area frames, the properties are exclusively controlled through the .ini file. You set them in the area frames section. One option is to assign properties to frame. The name frame is a special frame. This one is used for all frames that do not have a name or are not in the list of area frames in the usage.ini. This is necessary to allow an existing application to be pimped without renaming existing area frames. In most cases, the area frame does not have a name because the developer never gave it one. So here are some examples. It's basically frame name equals uframe and then the properties between brackets. In this example, back color of this frame has been set to powder blue again. There's a more precise way, and then you would use frame name dot component name. So it's really per component. Here is an example of giving the info area frame a border on every form. So that will be info equals uframe bracket border type equals flat border color equals dodgy blue bracket. And here's an example of giving the area frames on the form customer 001 a shadow. That would be something like frame.customer 001 equals uframe drop shadow color is navy. So this really allows you to control the look of your application without to having to recode. And that's an important value, and that's why I put it in the big red in big red characters. So the named area frames. The concept of named area frames may not sound familiar to you. In Uniface, it always has been possible to rename area frames in Form Painter, but it had a practical use only when printing. Area frames can have a name which is used to address them from the uses.ini file. The name can be changed in the Form Painter and does not have to be unique. Now, named area frames, as I said, can be renamed in the Form Painter and addressed from the uses.ini file. In this slide, there's an example. It's in the section of area frames. The frame is called BOK, B-O-K. And we're sort of showing the whole shop to you here with a back color of Dodger blue, back color fill gradient, drop shadow color gray. Back color start light yellow, radius around the edges, a back image which is called fourballs.png, a vertical align to the bottom, an horizontal align to the left, preserve aspect set to true, an edge scale of 50 and a V scale of 50. And this all together would then look like this. This is the fourballs.png. And of course, here you see the gradient, here you see the drop shadow, the rounded edges, etc., etc. So, concluding these new properties, there are some considerations. For instance, for the attached property, the widgets inside the area do not inherit the attached property of the area. So you would have to set them per widget within the area. So if the widgets need to move with the area, you need to give them an attached property too. We will see that in the demo later on. Considering printing, the properties are ignored when the area frame or entity is printed. So the scope is mainly GUI, or I should say GUI only. About the color inheritance, fields or widgets on top of the area frame or entity will only inherit the back color property value and do not take the gradient into account when inheriting the color. And considerations about the Form Painter. The Form Painter will display entity and area frames with the properties that are set in the .ini file. But however, you will not see the effect of the properties set in the more properties form. So, to conclude this part, we have an example of same entity with different properties. Left one is Jasper's little baby, and right one is Theo's little baby. And of course, they both have the triangle back image again. But for instance, if you do the left-right comparison on the slide, Jasper's version has the H line on left, Theo has the H line on right. The vertical line for Jasper is on the bottom, vertical line for Theo on the top, which means that Jasper's triangle is all the way here and Theo's triangle is all the way here. So there are some difference in the back color, red, and here the back color is green. It's for both, it's a gradient. Jasper starts at the left with a gradient. Theo starts at the bottom. Jasper has a back color start, which is pink. Theo has a back color start, which is blue. Border types are both flat. Border color is both red. Jasper chose a border radius of 5 pixels and Theo chose a border radius of 10 pixels. The drop shadow color for Jasper is dark red, as you see here, and Theo took the magnificent color of magenta, which it suits, I suppose. Okay, we've come to the end of part two of this presentation. How are we doing on questions so far?
Not many questions. I think Daniel's saving them all up.
We're waiting for your questions, Daniel. Yeah, you made us a promise. Okay, so over to part three of this presentation. I have to mention that part two and part three are based on blogs. Part two is a blog by Jasper, which is already on uniface.info. I can really recommend for you all to read this blog because it has more details than I can put in some PowerPoint slides, of course. And you can really it can really help you to understand and to play around with these properties. The modernization plan in 10 easy steps is I would always say almost say a trilogy by Theo, which means he wrote three blocks on uniface.info, and we're going over this plan in this part. So back to the requirements of the UDE, the Uniface 9.7 UDE. It should have a new start page. A white background should it have, because gray is sort of associated with old-fashioned. White background is nowadays sort of common sense and sort of professional looking. Any other background colors are not that professional looking. As said before, the idea was having flat buttons in a Windows 8 or Windows 10 style. It should have a fresh look. It should differ from Uniface 9.6, and this project should be done in low cost and low time. Time is money, of course. So here is a URL which shows the blog post that I mentioned before. All URLs in the PowerPoint are clickable and will lead you towards the blog. And we will make sure that the PowerPoint will be on SlideShare late this afternoon or early tomorrow morning. So it will be available for you, as will be the recording. So the start page. Again, the difference between Uniface 9.6 and previous versions and the Uniface 9.7. I already elaborated on the details of the start screen. So what about the colors and the buttons and the menus and the panels? Well, the white background, here it is. This is the old version of the screen. Here's a new version, old version, new version, going from gray to white, going from this type of button to this type of button. I can't see the mouse. Oh, okay.
You'd have to point.
Okay. So I just got some feedback from Christy that obviously you people cannot see my mouse moving. So I will take that into account. So to get this white background. This seems fairly simple. Make the background of all forms white. That will be the goal. This can be accomplished by a simple change in the .ini file. Included in this step is altering the application shell, the menus and the panels so they look nice in combination with the white forms. These are the actual values that are now in the .ini file for the Uniface 9.7 UDE. You see the back color white for all the windows, and the shell has a sort of very light blue color. And here are the values that that are used. Yeah, as you can see, the team made the application shell very light blue for a subtle color difference between the forms and the application shell. Forms were given a white background, menus are now white with a blue selection color, and the panels are white with blue accepts. This was all done with the properties that already existed in Uniface 9.6 and 9.6 and earlier. The challenge. In theory, changing the .ini settings should be enough, but unfortunately, a small percentage of the forms had either an index color or foreground color or background color set. That was never noticed before because these were set to the default gray background and black foreground, so they did not stand out on the gray screens before. So after the changing the .ini file, these forms remained gray. The challenge is to find all forms with a color and remove the color with minimal effort. And the team, mainly Theo, has built some tools, and these tools are also available for download. These tools are not supported by Uniface, so use them at your own risk. And I would always advise to create a sort of sandbox development environment for yourself to start with. And of course, use proper staging and version control, as every developer should. This first tool for step one is called the U97 underscore form color. No pointer. So if you would hit the retrieve button, second button from the left, it will show all forms in your dictionary that have an index color or form property color set. It uses your current settings in the foreground slash normal and the background slash normal sections of your current .ini file to translate the index color to foreground and background color. It will also show what window color you have set in the .ini file. There are buttons to convert RGB values to hex value colors and vice versa. These are in the middle of the form. And there are buttons to put the index color in the Windows properties and remove the index color. One that only does that when there is no window property color, and one that does it always, two separate buttons on the form. And there is a button to remove the property color when it's the same as the .ini color. Nothing gets stored until you press the store button, the one on the right. So you can play around a little without actually modifying your property yet. And of course, you're completely free to, once you've downloaded these tools, to change the tool and change them to for your own purposes. Going over to step two of this modernization plan. Here's an example of some strange gray areas in a white form. Strange gray blobs on some of the nice white screens. What is this? Some of the painted entities had an index color or foreground color or background color set and were painted as markers for referential integrity or other technical reasons. This must sound very familiar to Uniface developers because it's the way things are done in Uniface development, mainly in client server, back from the old days as well. To be precise, these only show up when they are painted three or more characters cells white. The team needed to remove these colors as well. The challenge in this step is to find all painted entities on all forms that have a color set and to remove the colors with minimal effort. Using SQL is not an option as the index color for the painted entities is stored in the paint area, the form pick. So here comes another tool. Oh, it's not on my slide. Anyway, there is a small tool to search for painted entities with a color and a few additional buttons to manipulate or remove the color. Since the index color of a painted entity is stored in a form paint tableau, the team had some fun deciphering and manipulating that. The tool is called U97_andColorform. When you press retrieve, it will retrieve all painted entities that have an index color or an entity property color set. On a large dictionary, this can take some time as it has to search the paint areas, the form picks, for the index colors. All buttons on this tool have the same function as on the previous tool. And I will show all of these tools in the demo part later on. So in step three, after step two, there were still unfortunately, a few gray blobs like these. Some entities had a foreground or background color set in the application model. So no index color there. And they were painted as markers for referential integrity or other technical reasons. So this step three is pretty similar to step two. These colors needed to be removed as well. The challenge was to find all entities in all models that have a color set and remove it with minimal effort. The tool is called U97AndColorMod. It searches for modeled entities with a color and has a few additional buttons to manipulate or remove the color. It works very similar to the previous tools. The differences are caused by entities in the application model not having index colors. Getting to step four of this modernization project. The visibility of grids. A grid always has a white background, and on our now white forms, it was not so clear to see what area a grid was occupying on a form, like you see on the left. So borders were needed around these grids. And to get these borders, the new Uniface 9.7 properties were used, namely border type flat and border color equals silver, as you see on the right, and then you get the form on the right. The challenge in this step was to find all painted grids and to apply this change, so border type and border color, with minimal effort. And again, there is some tooling. The tool is called U97 Grid Border. This one was kept very simple. It just retrieves all the entities that are painted as grids, and it has a button and to add properties to them. I will show you this tool in a demo later on also. Going to step five, multi-occurrence entities. This was an issue that was specific for the lab project of the modernization of the Uniface UDE, but we thought it would be interesting enough to include it in this presentation, because you may want to update properties of non-grid entities too. Earlier, the team removed the color from all entities, but in the development environment, there are multi-occurrence entities that need to look similar to grids. So someone tried very hard to imitate a grid, perhaps even before the grid was invented. Since grids do not follow the background color of the form, but always stay white, the team had to make these multi-occurrence entities consistent with that. Like in step four, a white data area on a white form does not look so good without some kind of border. So the team wanted to add new properties for the entity frame too. And in Uniface 9.7, there are these new properties for the default entity: border color, border type, border radius, drop shadow color, back color start, back color fill, gradient start, attach and attach margin. So again, border type flat and border color equals silver. And then you get the picture on the right. Just popping back to step five. The challenge was finding all painted entities that are not using a grid widget and are painted with a vertical repetition of occurrences. This information is stored in the form paint. Applying border color equals silver and border type equals flat to those entities. And again, there's a tool. The tool is called U97_multi_org. When you press retrieve, it shows all entities that are painted with an occurrence repetition and that is not a grid. It can be slow on large dictionaries as this tool also needs to look in the paint area of the form for each painted entity. Functionality is simple, just a button to add some properties to all painted entities found. So over to step six, the buttons. In this final episode of the story about the modernization of the Uniface 9.6 UDE in 10 easy steps, we will explain how the team changed the look of the buttons from this old gray to the white with the blue buttons. And again, changing the button also seems simple. Just changing the .ini file, but there are some buts. In every application, you will probably have a group of buttons. For instance, the buttons on the lower part of a screen, often containing the OK and the Cancel button. Most applications will have a set of buttons on the right side of the of a screen. So these have to be logically grouped, and the lab team came down to this grouping, namely the IDF button bottom for the big buttons at the bottom of the forms, IDF button side for the big text buttons at the right hand side of the forms, IDF button special for all the other buttons that did not fall in the first two categories. IDF button image for the very small buttons with an image on them, like the more button. And lastly, the IDF button header for the buttons that form the headers of simulated grids. So the column-like things where you can click on to sort. So, flat buttons. Seems simple, but... Steps 7, 8, and 9 are closely related, and for that you have to take a look at the inheritance of properties, which of course goes from down in this picture, the logical widget in the .ini file, gets overruled by the modeled field, which then gets overruled by a field painted on a component. So in step 7, the modeled widget, must be matched with the painted widgets. Put most used logical widget in the model. Step 8, set the properties on the painted buttons. Remove as much as possible to enable control via the .ini file. And step 9, set properties on modeled buttons. Remove as much as possible to enable control via the .ini file, because this is what you want. And step 10, at last, testing, of course. With a project like this, functionality is not really touched, so nothing should fall over and functionality should be fine. But does everything look okay? There could be opportunities where a local variation of a button has a reason, and perhaps now with the tooling you have removed that. And that should then be visible in your testing. And again, I strongly advise to use proper staging and version control in every form of development. So also in a project like this. Referring once again to the blog posts on uniface.info for much more details on each step of this 10-step plan, much more details than I can show you in some PowerPoint slides on the WebEx. The URLs link directly to part one, part two, and part three of Theo's blog. And the other URL is links directly to a zip file, which contains all the tools for the 10-step plan. Please take also a proper look at the big yellow disclaimer saying the tools described in this posting are not supported Uniface software. You can download them and use them, modify to your own taste and use them at your own risk. You will need the DICT model to be present in your repository before you can compile and use the tool. Be absolutely sure you have a backup of your dictionary before using any of these tools. You can download the tools in that link or in the link on top of the slides. It's to the same URL. If you make an improvement to these tools that might be useful to the community, please share them. We like to learn from you. So shortly getting back to the freshness of Uniface 9.7, blue colors were selected for buttons, menus, panels, and the application shell. And the small image buttons have no button shape behind those. And here is a good overview of the differences between 9.6 and 9.7. 9.6 on the top left and 9.7 in the center of the slide. And you have a good overview of all the different look and feel. Because this project was done on the budget, it's not perfect. So there are some known issues and things to keep in mind. For instance, the frames of the widgets are not fully consistent. It was camouflaged by the gray background of forms, but it shows more clearly on white. Also, new entity frame properties work fine, but in a multi-occurrence situation where the entity is made to look like a grid, they have some visual imperfections. And third, the buttons in the IDF used to have images on them in Uniface 7, but not since then. These are still image buttons. In 9.6, there was not a problem because we used the representation equals windows for the buttons, but flat buttons have representation equals Uniface. So now the image prevents correct centering of the text in these buttons. So there's some more stuff, sort of bonus. It's now finally, I would say, possible to set the IDF title bar in your ASN file. It's done in the logical section of your ASN file by saying IDF title equals, and you can then define your own title for your IDF. And it's very useful, I think, for every developer to have a good separate IDFs for like your development environment, your test environment, your acceptance testing, etc., etc. So you will always know in which IDF you are working at the moment. So it's time for part four, the demo. How are we doing on the
there's some questions. I don't know if you can see Chris's PC, but there's some questions about the H move and V move. I don't know if you're going to cover that with your demo.
Yeah, I have a screen which demos the H move and the V move. So perhaps we can do the demo and then see if that's answer enough. Anything else?
No, there's one question about the color handling, but I need to get an answer from that one, and I'll post the answers in the forums.
And there is a tool for step two and three, right? That you just showed?
Yes. There is not for all steps a tool, but I think steps one up until five have tools. But you will see that in the demo shortly anyway. So, I have to quickly switch over to a virtual machine and stop presenting my PowerPoint. So I suggest for you people to take a sip of your tea or your coffee, and I will be back shortly. is this not present? Yep, okay. Loading. And there it is. Yep. Yeah, and my virtual Windows 10 machine is coming up. Perhaps some of you have spotted the Uniface Anywhere icons over here for my former presentation. What I'm going to do, I'm going to make the screen a bit larger. I'm going to my project directory. Starting up Uniface 9.7. And my resolution is gone again. Okay, no problem. We'll have a very big resolution this afternoon, and it will be very visible for the audience. So here are the different different themes. So if I go to mobile, I have shortcuts related to the mobile theme. If I go to web, shortcuts related to the web. And desktop, shortcuts related to the desktop. You can, let me get this one out of the way. In your preferences, the presentation preferences, this should all look familiar to you if you are a Uniface developer, except for the left top part. There's the radio button. Start page, mobile, web, desktop, or integration. Here you can set your favorite starting points. If you work, if you develop a lot for mobile or web, you can choose that one. And if you develop a lot for the desktop, you can choose that one. So I've chosen the desktop, as you can see. So I always start with the yellow part. So here are the some shortcuts I have added. So this is the part that is customizable. I can click on every column, sort them, even on creation time. There is a search as you type function on top, like this. Here are all the tools. And if I sort them on the description, I've changed the description with the steps. So there are tools for step 1, step 2, step 3, 4, 5, and then step 6 and step 9. I have to add to this that these tools, of course, were custom made for this lab project of modernizing the Uniface UDE. Which means that not necessarily all these tools are necessary for your application. Or the other way around, perhaps you would come across to a unique situation in your application that is not covered in the lab modernization project. In this latter case, you would have to create your own tool to solve your problem. But of course, you could take a peek at how these tools are programmed and get some inspiration from that. So back to all the shortcuts. First, I'm going to show you this form. This short form has almost all the new properties in it. And if I run it, we can sort of play with it. For instance, attaching it to the left, here it goes. Attaching it to the right, here it goes, to the top, to the bottom. If you do an H move, if you do a V move, we can play a bit with the colors, like this. This is the back color. Here's your border color in black. A drop shadow color in dark green. So now you have the drop shadow. Foreground color is now hardly readable, so I will use some dark blue, royal blue, number 4. Back color start. the gradient starts. We would need a back color for that. First, define a gradient like this. So here we have a gradient starting at the right, going to the left. There is a field for the border radius. So if I'm increasing the size of the border radius, my corners get more round and round. Here's the thing with the back image, and the four balls are back, and they are moving with the screen altogether. So this is pretty much all the possibilities with the new new properties. And my guess is that this would also cover the question about the H move and the V move. Yeah. So we will make sure that this form is also available on uniface.info to download, and you can then import it in your repository and also play with it. And again, I can advise to read Jasper's blog on styling entities and area frames in Uniface 9.7, because the blog contains more details than my presentation. So closing this screen, and now using the search function, I really going to like this. And sorting on the steps of the, I'm now switching over to the third part, the 10 steps modernization plan. So taking a look at the first tool, it looks like this. If I run it, it looks like this. I have to say, in my repository, I have imported a very classic demo application back from Uniface 9.7. With great thanks to Dave Yexley, who still had this in his personal museum. We migrated, Bert Hogendoorn, my colleague from services, professionally migrated this application to 9.7. So it's now in my 9.7 repository. Thanks, Bert. And we're going to use these tools on this Formula One application. So I'm going to do a retrieve. And yeah, apparently no hits found. Like I said before, it's no guarantee that all these tools are necessary for your project, for your application. So we can sort of skip step one for the Formula One application. Going over to step two, running the form, doing a retrieve, and here is something. These are all very familiar names: W driver, W entrant, iCar, iDriver. These are index forms. It all has to do with Formula One, of course. The buttons from left to right. It starts with the retrieve. Then there is a conversion function from RGB to hexa. I'm clicking it now and converting it back. Migrating the index color to property color when empty, goes like this. Migrate the index color to property color always, as I explained in that part of the presentation. And removing the property color when it's the same as the window color. As long as you don't hit the store button on the right, nothing has been changed in your repository. And you can still do a clear, do another retrieve, and play some more. So this is step two. This is the tool. Okay, taking a sip of my tea because we have some lag. And we're back to the start form, where I now open the step three tooling. And I run it, I do a retrieve, and step three also has no hits in my project, so I can just forget about this. There's no need to use this tool. that was the entity column modification tooling. Over to the step four tooling for the grid. When I test it and retrieve it, we do have some hits. However, these hits are the components of the tooling themselves. So there's no need to change anything in this, because we would then change the tooling forms themselves. I will still demo some of this. The properties border type flat and border color silver, you may remember that this was done to have a better outline of the area of a grid widget. And with a button, we can now easily add them to the full property string, as you can see. And again, if I don't hit store, nothing has been changed yet in the property. And I'm going to the next tool. Step five tooling, the multi-occurrence. You may remember the occurrence that very hard to try it to be a grid widget before the grid widget was invented. When I run it, do a retrieve, here it is. So we have quite a lot of these multi-occurrence things. For instance, in the driver entity, the race entity, so it's all in on model level, entrant and car, all very familiar items in the Formula One application, of course. So you would like to add back color equals white, border type equals flat, and border color equals silver easily to these components. So it's basically a very simple tool, this one. There is a button to apply these properties, and bingo, they have been applied. And the next step would be to hit store to save these changes into your repository. Okay, closing this one, going to the next one. So step six, the form widgets. Taking a short break again to and we're good. So here's a retrieve, and the array dynamic is the demo form that I showed you with all the new properties on it. So this one would fall out of my scope of my Formula One application. The G underscore index is a Formula One form, so this would be in scope. A simple form to apply extra properties with a new value and a where value and a new widget type. And again, as long as you don't hit store, nothing is changed yet, and you can still experiment some more. And also again, one should always use perhaps a sandbox environment for the first steps in such a project, and use proper staging and version control. So going, not every step had tooling. There was even one step that had such a quick and dirty tooling that Theo did not dare to show this tool. So this is the last of the tooling for step nine, the mod widgets form. When I run it, I hit a retrieve. These are all dictionary things, so they would of course not be in scope of my project. So nothing for me here to here it is. Formula One model has some entities and fields which fall in the scope, And again, it's a fairly simple form. You can add a property name, add a new value, add a where clause, apply it, and define a new widget type and apply it, and then store it. So this brings me to the end of the presentation, of the demo and of the presentation. How are we doing on questions?
Yeah, we're all right with questions, I think.
Okay. I'll then shortly make this one disappear. And I can do it like this. Yep, and we're good. And again, the changing back to the PowerPoint creates some lag, but we're up to speed again. So this was the end of the demo. Of course, you can always follow us online, on YouTube, on LinkedIn, on Twitter, on Facebook, and on SlideShare, where we post these presentations. On our website, uniface.com, and also on the uniface.info.com, and especially the forum. We have a very lively forum. You're welcome to join and ask all kinds of questions. I would like to thank you all for joining this afternoon. If there are no more questions.
No, I don't think so.
No, okay.
Need to remove Daniel from the forums before he puts any more questions in there. So, everybody, we're going to wrap this up. So a couple of just key things I did send in chat. First of all, this presentation we're going to make available on SlideShare. That'll probably go up tomorrow. And then we're also going to create a series of recordings for the different sections of this presentation. I don't know exactly when we'll have those ready, but we'll make those available on YouTube, and we will also post into the uniface.info forums that these are available. There's also the demo app, the little sample, which sort of shows how to use some of the functionality. We'll put that up onto the sample section of uniface.info as well. We'll try and get that done in the next couple of days. So, and any questions, please dump them into the forums and we'll pick them up and work on them and hopefully answer them for you. There's also a few questions that we've captured from both this morning and this afternoon's sessions. We'll put the questions and the answers up in the forums over the next few days, okay? So uniface.info, the forums, very important.
Okay. The Formula One app. Can we make the Formula One app available?
Who wrote it?
Yeah, I think it's an it used to be a demo app back in Uniface 7.
Okay. So the question came about making the Formula One app available as a reference. I don't think there's an issue with doing that. It is just a very old app. I think I can remember using it when I was a qualified trainer way back when in the version 7 days. So we can make it available, but please just be aware that there's new stuff which has been made available in the product which will potentially supersede some of those techniques and so forth. But we're more than happy to take a look at sharing it. So again, watch this space and we'll see what we can do there, okay? So we'll wrap everything up and thanks everybody for attending. I think in total we've had about 140, 150 people across the two sessions, which is fantastic. And as somebody has just said, yep, we'll look forward to the next one as well. It's been fantastic. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much and goodbye.